Chapter 2, Philosophy and Spirituality. Part 1. Spirituality postulates that the truth is never given to the subject by right. Foucault. In order to fully grasp the implications of the Dionysian and Apollonian for an art of the transpersonal self, I now will return once more to ancient Greece, this time with Michel Foucault. The main source here will be his seminal lecture at the Collège de France, later on being published as the Hermeneutics of the Subject. Connecting points to the previous chapter are immediately apparent. Foucault chooses to start his analysis of ancient Greece at the very point at which Nietzsche breaks off, namely the moment of rupture occurring with Plato and Socrates. What, however, is of even greater importance is that Foucault focuses on what properly can be called an art of living, and that he is concerned with the process of subjectivation, both of which make his approach so suited for the theoretical grid. With Michel Foucault, Friedrich Nietzsche's more general observations are thus given a concrete shape, and the question of individual subjectivation is broached. This chapter will approach and analyze certain technologies of the self, which, as I will argue, can be reinterpreted along the lines of the relationality of the Apollonian and Dionysian. At the end of this chapter, it will be possible to draw the findings from the first theoretical part of this work together. Yet, this chapter also aims at gaining an insight into how an art of living has already been practiced, concretely, in the history of the West. The objective here is not to call for a resuscitation of a Greek or generally antique way of living. This is neither possible nor desirable. We are no longer ancient Greeks, and neither do we live in antiquity. Calling for such a resuscitation also would imply to overlook the many unsavory aspects of ancient existence: slavery, exclusion of women, and the derisory treatment of foreigners are only the most glaring of those. Yet, our current living and the possible forms of subjectivation available at any given moment in time are, to a certain extent, also influenced and co-determined through the way our historical horizon has been constructed. In this sense, shedding a different light on this construction, unhurting different traditions and highlighting blocked or abandoned developments can also give some pointers as to the present state of being. If there is validity to the Foucauldian claim that will be advanced here in this chapter, namely that between the Platonic and the Christian model of subjectivation, a third model, the Hellenistic heart of the self, has been buried, then this might also give some further insights into the hegemony of Apollo established in the last chapter. As the task and experiment of this book, furthermore, is the relinking of the Apollonian Dionysian towards an art of the transpersonal self, taking a close look at the historical precedents which have co-determined the present might well be crucial, not to resuscitate pre-Socratic Greece, but to find out what such an art of living can still mean for us, living today as we are in our own local, contingent but also impure, and thus to a certain degree open horizon. 2.1. Placing the hermeneutics of the subject. The course Michel Foucault taught at the Collège de France during the winter of 1981-82 was named the Hermeneutics of the Subject. Transcribed into book format, this course has only recently appeared in English language, in 2005, and only now stands to take up a place in Foucault's overall trajectory of thought for Anglophones. Despite such a slow reception, this course is remarkable in several ways and thus receives a central place here. First of all, it provides a glimpse at the period of Foucault's long pensive silence, which spanned from the publishing of the first volume of the History of Sexuality in 1976 to its succeeding volumes 2 and 3, The Use of Pleasure and The Care of the Self in 1984. During those years of reflection, Foucault's thought shifted direction, moving away from the preoccupation with power towards the question of ethics and the possibility of an art of living. In other words, during those years, Foucauldian thought turns from what is commonly termed the middle phase to the late and final phase. Didier Eribon, one of Foucault's biographers, remarks that this long period of silence led to any number of rumors and comments. Foucault was finished. He had nothing more to say. He was at an impasse. In Insight, it is easy to diffuse those rumors with a reference to the many vibrant and extraordinary lectures which Foucault gave during this time, of which the ones at the Collège de France just form a part. Those lectures show that, far from being finished, Foucault had expanded his studies into new realms. Similarly, rather than seeing this move from the middle to the late phase of Foucault's work as a break with, or even contradiction of earlier thought, as many of his critics are still quick to do, it might more accurately be termed a Verwendung. We can understand such a Verwendung in this context as a movement of thought by which earlier elements are twisted into a new position and thus re-evaluated and partially put into a different frame and redrawn without, however, just declaring them obsolete, without discarding or overcoming them in light of something that will be more true than that which had been taught previously. This can be exemplified by using Gilles Deleuze's book Foucault as example. Discussing the works of the later Foucault, Deleuze demonstrates how the concepts of earlier phases continue to inform Foucault also during the time of his focus on ancient Greece. The focus has shifted, and rather than positioning a break, Deleuze traces how the questions of relations of force, resistance, and the Nietzschean idea of the historicity, contingency, and finitude of the human subject, which have earlier on led Foucault to proclaim the death of man and to seek to analyze constellations of power, now continue to inspire his work, although in a different fashion. It is on this background that the problem of how it still might be possible to lead a life of active subjectivation, of co-creating the own subjectivity and attaining an understanding of ethics that is not guided by a Christian morality, gains relevance. The hermeneutics of the subject also marks the period of time in which Foucault more and more approaches philosophy. Had he earlier, in a Nietzschean gesture, repudiated claims to academic philosophy, this course is a step towards a critical re-engagement with this discipline. What is evident in this course is that Foucault, while still criticizing the idea of philosophy as single means of accessing the truth, also comes to espouse the idea of philosophy as something that can be combined with a practice of spirituality and thus change the subject in its very being. Together, they can make the subject aware of what has silently been taken for granted and inspire an exhilarating move towards as of yet uncharted becomings. This understanding is risky, as it opens and demands the possibility for the philosopher to let her, himself, be transformed by the practice. Quote, "This is a form of philosophy which demands that the individual, to borrow Nietzsche's phrase, risks himself constantly. It involves more than the search for objective knowledge, which has no implication for the subject's mode of existence." O'Leary. Towards this end, Foucault couples the idea of philosophy with the concept of spirituality.
The latter
stresses and accentuates the active part of practice and signifies a move into an experiential field beyond the realm of pure knowledge. This will be discussed in more detail throughout this chapter. During the time of this 1981-82 course at the Collège de France, Foucault was working on the yet unpublished volume 2 and 3 of his History of Sexuality, the figure of the care of the self, which would become the title to the third volume of this history, appears extensively in this course. The main difference is that in the care of the self, Foucault approaches the figure of care with an ethical question in mind. He is interested in the ethical stance that inspires this practice of the care in ancient Greece. In the hermeneutics of the subject, he approaches the self from the point of view of practices, trying to discern the workings and composition of this distinctive art of living. If the hermeneutics of the subject deserves a special place here, it is firstly because it shows clearer than any other of his works this practical side of Foucault's project. Already as regards the title, Wilhelm Schmidt remarks that the hermeneutics should be understood as referring to technologies and concrete practices of the self. What Foucault so aims to isolate in this course is the practices, the techniques, and methods which over the period of antiquity were used to actively work on the self. During this course, Foucault explores in great clarity and detail the practical aspects of an aesthetic of existence as it had already been lived about 2,000 years ago. In the Foucauldian toolbox, we here find models for a how-to, which can serve as guiding threads for thinking about concrete practices for a 21st century art of the transpersonal self. Secondly, this course not only highlights the tradition, what he terms the Hellenistic model, which Foucault tries to unearth from previous oblivion, but also gives us an insight into what he wants to set himself apart from. It shows us what he rejects as much as what he proposes. It is in this respect that commentators like Michael Ure point to the critical distinction which Foucault makes between his project and the Christian model against which he sets out. It is this Christian model which, according to Foucault, was partially responsible for the obliteration of those practices which had previously enabled an active and positive preoccupation with the self. In the morally inspired hostility of the early church fathers, in their condemnation and vilification of the care of the self, what has been eradicated from our philosophical and ethical heritage is a fertile tradition that offers us alternative images, techniques, ideas, and practices for theorizing the self's relationship to itself. Quote from Ure. This Christian condemnation of the care of the self as immoral and narcissistic served to eventually smother a vibrant tradition which hetero had linked ethics and aesthetics in an art of existence. The other model from which Foucault seeks to dissociate his project is what he terms the Platonic model. The Platonic model, in Foucault's rendering, overly favors what would later be termed the ratio, the rational form of cognition, leading first to philosophy as the principle of knowledge and later on the scientific method as exclusive road to accessing the truth. In the Cartesian cogito, both this rationality and the idea of the autonomous self-grounded subject of enlightenment and modernity are enshrined. It is in distinction to those principles that Foucault's hermeneutics of the subject looks to a Hellenistic model to gain pointers towards an alternative. After Timothy O'Leary, The title, Hermeneutics of the Subject, so is misleading, for it defines not so much Foucault's project, but what he set out against. It is this hermeneutics which aims at deciphering the truth of the soul, at interpreting and confessing every movement of thought from which Foucault wants to separate the Hellenistic model's practices of the active transformation of the self. The double bind of sacrifice and renunciation that goes along with such a hermeneutical approach for Foucault appears to be too high a price to pay for subjectivation. On the road to an art of the transpersonal self, this course at the Collège de France provides a crucial stepping stone as it sheds a clearer light on certain practical aspects and elements of late Foucauldian thought, while also providing a brilliantly lucid overview on what it sets itself apart from. In this later respect, it is also uniquely suited for our purposes because it distinguishes the concept of self from the modern tradition of the Cartesian cogito on the one hand, without letting itself get ensnared in the entanglements of the moral trap on the other. Ultimately, it is in critical distinction to those two concepts that also my current study aims to establish itself. 2.2. Philosophy and spirituality, knowledge of the self and care of the self. Foucault based this course on the hermeneutics of the subject, on the distinction between two principles in ancient Greece. The first principle he calls the principle of philosophy and identifies it with the Delphic precept of know yourself, noti soton. The second one he names the spiritual principle, the care of the self, epimeleia, heotou. He defines the first one, the philosophical principle, as the one which is concerned with the conditions of possibility of knowledge and the formalized mechanisms that regulate the access to truth. Quote, we will call, if you like, philosophy, the form of thought that asks, not of course what is true and what is false, but what determines that there is and can be truth and falsehood, and whether or not we can separate the true and the false. We will call philosophy the form of thought that asks what it is that enables the subject to have access to the truth and which attempts to determine the conditions and limits of the subject's access to truth. Foucault. This first principle of know yourself, the philosophical principle, is also the principle of cognition, which leads to knowledge. The second principle, the care of the self, which Foucault alternatively also identifies as a spiritual principle, is related to a set of practices like ascetic or meditations that the self performs. Like the knowledge of the self, also this second principle is related to truth. Foucault characterizes spirituality as being the form of practices which postulate that, such as he is, the subject is not capable of truth, but that, such as it is, the truth can transfigure and save the subject. Access to truth, in this instant, is linked to an additional necessity not directly derived from knowledge, philosophy. Accessing this truth is not possible via just a form of cognition, leaving the self unaltered in its being, but only through the combination of the knowledge of the self with a spiritual practice, care of the self. As Foucault argues in the quote above, the subject, as it is, remains incapable of truth. Truth is much rather related to a practice of transformation of the self. Only in this interplay between knowledge of the self and practice of transformation that comes from caring for oneself does a form of truth arise. The moment of truth is at the same time also the transfiguring moment of alteration and becoming. To summarize, through a certain combination of knowledge of the self, philosophy, and the practice of care of the self, spirituality, a transfiguring moment of becoming, of truth. We shall now look at this notion in more detail. In the spiritual, practical element, there is an active element of care, epimeleia, which is stressed. It is not to be mistaken with a narcissistic or egocentric form of self-love, but is, on the contrary, always related to some kind of work one performs on oneself. Quote, the notion of epimeleia does not merely designate this general attitude or this form of attention turned on the self. The term also always designates a number of actions exercised on the self by the self, actions by which one takes responsibility for oneself and by which one changes, purifies, and transforms oneself. Foucault. This work of care is undertaken first for the spiritual and physical well-being, but secondly also for transformative purposes. It is important to point out that the care of the self is not synonymous to the modern idea of self-help. It is much rather the affirmative practice of an active self and not intended as cure for a supposed deficiency in normalcy. There is no overall standard of normality to be reached, but neither is there an abstract ideal of perfect enlightenment underlying this concept of care of the self, nor a progressive path towards higher illumination to be followed. Simultaneously, this understanding of spirituality should not be confused with a religion. Although Foucault himself does not state such a difference explicitly, it can be argued that the differentiation between spirituality and religiosity, opened by some of the founding figures of transpersonal psychology, Kristina and Stanislav Grof, also applies in this case. Following their distinction, the main difference between spirituality and religiosity consists in the fact that the latter is tied to an institutional frame and formalized code of conduct, whereas the former entails the search for personal transcendence without recurring to an abstract and institutionalized frame of reference. While religion thus implies the moral categories of an absolute truth and goes hand in hand with the church, spirituality can also exist without those formal hierarchical structures. Such spirituality, as practiced in the Foucauldian rendering via the care of the self, is much more a lifelong personal preoccupation, for which to begin with, it is never too late. Different stages in life will need different practices and different forms of care, but a special reason to start or continue them is not necessary. The necessary preconditions are none other than to first muster the required discipline to carry out the practice, and secondly, a willingness and openness to let oneself be transformed by them. They necessitate the odd couple of discipline and attentive flexibility, which is able to let go of old beliefs held dear and rational certainties that no longer fit the current conditions. Most practices thus can be conflictive, but this is done from the understanding, as we shall see at a later point, that conflict can also be a source of creative energy and thus a possible instigator and catalyst of transformation, instead of something to be prevented, avoided, or weeded out of one's existence. In the rebound effect of the truth unto the self, the subject is transfigured and transformed. It is so a form of salvation that becomes possible through this spiritual practice. This salvation, however, is not achieved in eternal afterlife in the Christian heaven, but is on the contrary an individual transfiguration that consists in the permanent work of the self on the self, and is a salvation that so has to be understood as, quote, an activity, the subject's constant action on himself, which finds its reward in a certain relationship of the subject to himself. One saves oneself for the self. One is saved by the self. One saves oneself in order to arrive at nothing other than oneself. Foucault. In Greek thought, up until Plato, Foucault argues, philosophy and spirituality were never separated, but perceived as interrelated and mutually conditioning each other. They were seen as dependent upon one another. In effect, he postulates, there existed a dynamic entanglement and reciprocal call between those two. Combining the two of them, philosophy and spirituality, the subject is able to effect a transformation of the self. This active moment of change for Foucault is generated through an instant of truth, when the self ceases to be who he, she was and becomes somebody different, becomes transformed and different. Those spiritual practices are therefore derived out of an affirmation of life and not out of a view on its deficiencies. The resulting practice of the self is neither identical to a rational cognition, nor is it religious. It is much rather a spiritual transformation, which Foucault alternatively describes as a transfiguration, conversion, transformation, being saved, enlightenment. 2.3. Truth, knowledge, practices, and transformation. The distinctions of this understanding of truth to the Platonic truth, already previously discussed, are readily apparent. Unlike the historically later Platonic and modern truth, this truth cannot be an abstract outside principle. It is not to be found in some pure realm of ideas, but is on the contrary an effect of putting into play knowledge combined with spiritual practice. Alone, neither of those two components will suffice. Quote, in short, I think we can say that in and of itself, an act of knowledge could never give access to the truth unless it was prepared, accompanied, doubled, and completed by a certain transformation of the subject. Not of the individual, but of the subject himself in his being as subject. Schematically, let's say that throughout the period we call antiquity, and in quite different modalities, the question of how to have access to the truth and the practice of spirituality, or the necessary transformations of the very being of the subject which allow access to the truth, these two questions, these two themes, were never separate. Foucault. Truth and personal transformation in this practice are intricately linked. In Foucault's words, it follows that from this point of view, there can be no truth without a conversion or a transformation of the self. The truth acquired is as radically different from the modern truth as it is necessarily personal, local, and contingent. Its concrete form will always depend on the specific work performed by the self on itself, on the specific elements of philosophy and spirituality put into play. This truth thus always is relational in all directions and relative instead of absolute. In the understanding of Gianni Vattimo, this would correspond partially to a weak truth, one which is aware of its own limitations, its contingency in time and space. The difference, however, consists in the circumstance that Vattimo's weak truth is of a rhetorical nature and opened to a discursive process of confirmation against an always already pre-given ruling horizon. Whereas the truth that is meant here, while also rising against a pre-given horizon, is not only of a rhetoric nature but contains a practical element which cannot discursively be expressed and thus confirmed, and so also cannot be known but only experienced. What so follows from this rendering is that neither this ancient pre-Platonic truth nor the transformation of the self can be grasped rationally. While it is possible to describe the conditions of knowledge necessary for the access to truth and so to arrive at an approximation of the concrete elements of the knowledge of the self, and while it may be possible to furthermore grasp the elements of practice in spirituality, rationality ultimately has to fall silent before the actual moment of transformation and the truth arising together with it. Note on spirituality. These practices could be a certain posture while meditating, a specific way of organizing one's thought, of concentrating or broadening the mind, a distinct way of breathing, but also regimens for dietetics, suggestions on how to keep a journal, etc. All of those practical requirements can still be described by rational means. Foucault, for example, analyzes in great detail the ancient practice of keeping journals, the hupomnemata, and dietetics. We have thus reached the, for the modern Western understanding paradoxical, point of truth that cannot be explained rationally, and a transformation of the self that likewise eludes rationality. Everything up until this moment of transformation is in principle open to rational description and analysis. But if Foucault's analysis is followed further, then it is exactly the twisting of knowledge about oneself through a spiritual practice that makes this transfiguration of the self possible. The peculiar point about spirituality is that it cannot be cognitively willed, although its foundations are also rational. The moment of transformation thus becomes transrational, as it has rational elements and a certain rational structure, but ultimately transcends rational explanations and cannot be grasped by those. Knowledge, philosophy, plays its crucial role, but does not suffice, as an explanation and analysis largely loses its prospective capacities. The outcome of such a transformative practice can so no longer be rationally preordained, and this makes such an art of transformation risky. On the other end, the position of imagined security, the flight into purely aesthetic, rational, and formal, makes the transformation of the self impossible. Only by embracing uncertainty and risk, by letting the rational mind fade to the background, can the transformation of the self open up as a possibility. Ultimately, at its limit point, such a transformation can thus only be experienced, as it cannot be argued. It is thus not the pull of a will to knowledge that is the driving force, but spirituality in its dynamic interrelation with the knowledge in Verwindung. Knowledge, taken as an abstract and formalized exterior quantity, can thus not effect a transformation of the self. Only if it is to some degree personalized and if it is coupled with a spiritual practice can it become a part of such a transformation. The same also applies to the concrete practices of the self Foucault analyzed in such great detail throughout certain periods of antiquity. What is to be found are practices and techniques of the self that derive from always local circumstances, that are tailor-made for and by the subject in his/her concrete circumstances, and that do not follow an abstract code of conduct or systematized set of rules. Both the philosophical knowledge and the spiritual practices are so specific to time, place, and person, and do not follow a moral rule understood as obedience to a system of laws or a codification of pleasures. What fascinates here is an art of living from which a spiritual, philosophical work on the self is derived, which does not rely on morals or strong truth. Foucault's rendering of the spiritual practices of Demetrius, a Cynic philosopher of the 1st century AD, could serve as a particular clear example of a knowledge that has already turned local and contingent. This example, furthermore, is of specific interest if what we ultimately want to approach is not just an art of the self, but an art of the transpersonal self. In his doubling of the spiritual practices, Foucault ascribes to Demetrius a notion of knowledge that is not absolute and abstract, but is localized and, so to speak, tailored to the individual person. Quote, "Well, I think we could call it, quite simply, a relational mode of knowledge. Because when we now consider the gods, other men, the cosmos, the world, etc., this involves taking into account the relation between the gods, men, the world, and things of the world on the one hand, and ourselves on the other." Describing a similar mode of acquiring knowledge, Jean-Paul Lederach coined the term of the elicitive to signify a relational form of awareness of the self in situation. Lederach, one of the leading figures in the realm of conflict mediation, has developed this term out of the idea that knowledge about right action is not prescriptively pre-given, but needs to be elicited from the concrete situation by being relationally aware of oneself and the home surroundings. Instead of following universal models, the elicitive approach implies an active and open attention to oneself and the way the own presence influences and shapes any given situation and is in turn influenced by it. This is not to say that knowledge works like this in each instance when employed together with spirituality, but that there is a certain precedence of relational knowledge in the spiritual practices, which indeed fits very easily into the energetic cosmovision we established with Wolfgang Dietrich in the last chapter. This energetic cosmovision, as we recall, derives from the contemplation of nature, society, and cosmos, and one's specific place and role therein. From this moment onwards, in light of the points sketched on the functioning and composition of philosophy and spirituality in the practices of transformation, the relation of those principles to the Apollonian and Dionysian can now be established. One can match the principle of philosophy to the Apollonian. In the beginning of this chapter, I defined with Michel Foucault philosophy as a form of thought which asks about the possibility of the access to truth. Philosophy in this definition becomes a formal, an aesthetic, an Apollonian element. And it is also no coincidence that the philosophic gnati sotun was the precept inscribed at the Delphic shrine, which was the sacred site of the eye cult of Apollo. This knowledge turns relational and local when coupled or brought in dynamic relation with spirituality, which always remains a personal practice. For, just as the energetic Dionysian harmony has to be local, also in the practice of spirituality, one cannot take care of the self in the realm and form of the universal. Foucault. Spirituality, that which aims for the transfiguration of the subject, yet cannot exist without the philosophical principle, can be understood as a specific form of reckoning for the Dionysian, a way of taking the principle of content and the energetic into account. The spiritual, energetic, or Dionysian adds the counter-spin to the rational Apollonian knowledge, philosophical, which gives their mutual dance a transrational twist. The theoretical advance gained here is that through Foucault's rendering, it now is possible to begin to approach an idea of a transformation of the self, an idea of how this cosmovision built on the Dionysian Apollonian could be operable for an art of the self. before progressing any further in order to obtain a clearer picture. It is still necessary to trace the similarities and differences to the two other great figures of work on the self arising in the last centuries BC and the first centuries AD. In short, this art of transformation needs to be differentiated from the Platonic method and the Christian conversion, as established in Foucault's Hermeneutics of the Subject. This analysis will be advanced via looking on the one hand at the practices that underline these three different models, but on the other hand especially by posing the question about which conception of subjectivity inspires them and which effects they aim for.